Good morning, everyone, and welcome to this Nativity Carol service. You're very welcome. I'm a little bit anxious. And we are here to remember some amazing things. Our reading is from Luke chapter 1, verse 10, and it says, I bring you good news. It will bring great joy for all the people. We're surrounded by bad news. And what a wonderful thing to come and consider good news this morning and to think of these events that bring great joy to all the people. So I'm going to hand over in a moment, to Hannah, who's going to explain the proceedings, and then I'll come and speak later.
Okay. So I'm going to say a very special hello to all the kids that we've got here today. And you're going to help me today. Now, I know at Christmas time, everybody loves telling stories, don't they? Lots of exciting stories that we tell at Christmas time. Well, today, I'd love your help to tell a very special story, a very special Christmas story. And it's special for two reasons. It's special because it's completely true. And it's special because it's the first Christmas story. It's the original Christmas story. It's the story of why we celebrate Christmas in the first place. Now, as we go through the story, you have the chance to dress up as the different people and characters that we meet in this story. So there's lots of things over here for you to put on. And if you want to do that, that's great. And if you don't, that's also fine. You can do as much or as little as you want. If you're shy and you want to stay with your mum or dad, whoever, that's absolutely fine. And then after each reading, I need your help because we're going to do some actions together to help us remember this very special story. So in our first reading, we're going to meet Joseph and we're going to meet some angels. Okay, so in a minute, during the song, if you want to be a Joseph or an angel, and I don't mind if we have five Josephs and two angels, it's fine. You can come over here and we'll get you all kitted out, okay? So as the kids get ready to dress up, and as we get ready for our first reading, we're all going to stand and sing together our first carol, O Come All You Faithful. So if you're able, let's please stand together and sing this carol.
Thank you.
Take your seats. Joe is now going to come and read the first part of our Christmas story. And kids, you need to have your listening ears on, because at the end, we're going to do some actions together, okay? So we're going to listen as Joe tells us the first part of the Christmas story.
This is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah came about. His mother Mary and Joseph had promised to get married. But before they started to live together, it became clear that she was going to have a baby. She became pregnant by the power of the Holy Spirit. Her husband Joseph was faithful to the law, but he did not want to put her to shame in public, so he planned to divorce her quietly. But as Jesus was thinking about this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. The angel said, "Joseph, son of David, don't be afraid to take Mary home as your wife. The baby inside her is from the Holy Spirit. She's going to have a son. You must give him the name Jesus. That's because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to bring about what the Lord had said would happen. He had said through the prophet, "The virgin is going to have a baby. She will give birth to a son, and he will be called Emmanuel." The name Emmanuel means God with us. Joseph woke up. He did what the angel of the Lord commanded him to do. He took Mary home as his wife, but he did not sleep with her until she gave birth to a son, and Joseph gave him the name Jesus.
Thanks, Joe. So we've got lots of great outfits going on here. If you're a Joseph, do you want to come and join me on this side? If you're an angel, do you want to come and join me on this side? Yeah, lots of Joseph. Oh, we've got a big Joseph as well. We're all doing well here today. So, as we were thinking in that reading, Joseph was confused a bit, wasn't he? There were lots of things going on that Joseph didn't really understand. That made Joseph feel quite confused. He decided to do one thing, and then an angel appeared and told him he had to do another thing. Can you do a very confused face for me? What do you look like when you're confused? What's going on? I don't understand. But even though Joseph didn't understand everything, he still said, "Yes, God." When the angel gave him the message, he went and did what God had told him to do. He said, "Yes, God." Can you do that for me? Do a big thumbs up. Yes, God. See, even though Joseph was confused, he said, "Yes, God." Now, in our next reading, we are going to meet Joseph again, but we're also going to meet Mary, and we're going to meet some animals. So if you want to swap your outfit to be an animal or Mary, then you can go and do that now. If you head over towards the boxes over there. Mark is now going to come and read the second part of our Christmas story.
From Luke chapter 2, verses 1 to 7, we read, "In those days, Caesar Augustus made a law. It required that a list be made of everyone in the whole Roman world. It was the first time a list was made of the people while Quirinius was governor of Syria. Everyone went to their own town to be listed. So Joseph went also. He went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea. That is where Bethlehem, the town of David, was. Joseph went there because he belonged to the family line of David. He went there with Mary to be listed. Mary was engaged to him. She was expecting a baby. While Joseph and Mary were there, the time came for the child to be born. She gave birth to her first baby. It was a boy. She wrapped him in large strips of cloth. Then she placed him in a manger. That's because there was no guest room where they could stay."
Great, thanks, Mark. So I don't know what we've managed to achieve in terms of dressing up over here. I think we've got some animals. If you're an animal, do you want to come and join us by the manger here? Because this is where you get your food from. Oh, we've definitely got a couple of donkeys. Yeah, we've got a couple of donkeys there. Oh, we've got a sheep. That's got another sheep. Wow, this is great. Do you have any Marys? I think I see a Mary over there. And we've got a Joseph. Perfect. So in our reading, we heard that Mary and Joseph had to travel a really long way all the way to Bethlehem. And when they got there, there wasn't even a spare room for them to stay in. They had to share with the animals. So animals, I just need your attention a second. I know you're busy eating. But we're just going to think, Mary and Joseph, they've travelled a long way, and Mary's baby is due any day now. How would they feel if there's nowhere to stay? Do you think they'd feel a bit worried? I think our donkeys are too busy eating. Right, everybody, can you give me your most worried face? What do you look like when you're worried? Oh, no! Oh dear! But Mary's baby arrived. She gave birth to the little baby Jesus. Oh, and she put him in the manger. How happy must Joseph and Mary feel that their baby has arrived? Can you show me what you look like when you're really, really happy? Can you give your really happy faces? That's great. Amazing. So, in our next reading, we're going to still need some sheep, we're going to need some shepherds, and we'll need some angels back, okay? So if you want to be any of those characters, then head over back to the boxes, and we'll see what we can do about that. And as the kids get ready for the next reading, we're all going to sing a carol together. We're going to sing the familiar O Little Town of Bethlehem. So if you're able, let's stand and sing this carol. Take your seats, and Colin is now going to come and read the next part of the Christmas story. And kids, if you want to take your seats as well, we need to be listening really hard because some exciting stuff is going to happen next, okay?
There were shepherds living out in the fields nearby. it was night, and they were taking care of their sheep. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. They were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news. It will bring great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. Here is how you will know I am telling you the truth. You will find a baby wrapped in strips of cloth and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a large group of angels from heaven also appeared. They were praising God. They said, "May glory be given to God in the highest heaven, and may peace be given to those he is pleased with on earth." The angels left and went into heaven. Then the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem. Let's see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby. The baby was lying in the manger. After the shepherds had seen him, they told everyone. They reported what the angel had said about this child. All who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary kept all these things like a secret treasure in her heart. She thought about them over and over. The shepherds returned. They gave glory and praise to God. Everything they had seen and heard was just as they had been told.
Thanks, Colin. So I think we've got here lots of shepherds. If you're a shepherd, why don't you come over here to this side, over here to this side, and you need your sheep with you as well, don't you? There's lots of sheep, lots of shepherds. We're doing well. Not so many angels, so I've had to volunteer. Now, was anybody listening as Colin read that next part of the Christmas story? What did the shepherds feel like when the angels turned up? Yes, Susie. Terrified. Now, terrified means very, very, very scared, okay? So can you do me your terrified face, your scared face? What do you look like when you've seen 10 spiders? Terrified. They were terrified, but the angels had a message of good news from God that they were bringing to the shepherds. And when the shepherds understood that good news, when they'd gone and found the baby Jesus lying in the manger, they were so, so excited. They were so excited that they ran off to tell everyone they knew the good news that they'd just heard and seen themselves. Now, imagine that. You're so excited, you can't help but tell people, and you don't want to walk anywhere. It's so exciting, you're going to have to run, okay? So, you all listening? I want you to run back to your seats very carefully, in a very excited way. Can you all do that? Run, 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 run. The shepherds were terrified, but once they saw the truth about Jesus, they were so, so excited. Right. In our next reading, we're going to meet lots of wise men, okay? So if you want to be a wise man, head over here towards the boxes and we'll get you ready for the next part of our story. And as you do that, Rebecca is going to come up and read the final part of our story, if she can get through the crowd.
Matthew chapter 2. Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea. This happened while Herod was king of Judea. After Jesus' birth, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem. They asked, "Where is the child who has been born to be king of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose, and now we have come to worship him." When King Herod heard about it, he was very upset. Everyone in Jerusalem was troubled too. So Herod called together all the chief priests of the people. He also called the teachers of the law. He asked them where the Messiah was going to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied. "This is what the prophet has written. He said, 'But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are certainly not the least important among the towns of Judah. A ruler will come out of you. He will rule my people Israel like a shepherd.'" Then Herod secretly called for the wise men. He found out from them exactly when the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem. He said, "Go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report it to me. Then I can go and worship him too." After the wise men had listened to the king, they went on their way. The star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them. It finally stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were filled with joy. The wise men went to the house. There they saw the child with his mother Mary. They bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures. They gave him gold, frankincense, and myrrh. But God warned them in a dream not to go back to Herod. So they returned to their country on a different road.
Thank you, Rebecca. So I've now got lots of wise men. If you're a wise man, do you want to come over here? Join me in a little huddle over here. Oh, lots of wise men. But before they got to the baby Jesus, they first went to visit bad King Herod, who was over here. Reuben, do you want to just stand up there so we can see bad King Herod? Oh, that's right, bad King Herod. So what are we going to do for bad King Herod? We're going to give him some booze. Boo! We don't like bad King Herod. But after they'd seen bad King Herod, they found out that they needed to go to Bethlehem. And the star showed them the way to go. They went to Bethlehem and they met God's good King, Jesus. Now, if you've got a gift and you're a wise man, do you want to give it to Jesus in the manger over here? Yeah. They gave him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And that was to show everybody that they knew that this little baby born laid in a manger was actually a really important and special king. Yeah, that's amazing, isn't it? Now, you've all been a great super help as we've told the Christmas story. Thank you so much for joining in. If you want to go and take all your costumes back to the boxes, that would be great. Thank you so much for your help. And if you come and find me at the end of the service, we're going to give out some special presents to all of you. Right. We're now all going to stand and sing a carol together, Silent Night, Holy Night. And after this carol, Ian's going to come and give a short message explaining the wonder of this Christmas story that we've looked at today. So if you're able, let's stand and sing Silent Night together.
Oh,
So we've been reminded of the first Christmas this morning. Some extraordinary things. This baby, in a manger, in an animal feeding trough, is Emmanuel, God with us. How we get our minds around that. And he's going to do amazing things. He's going to save his people from their sins. Now, what does that mean? I'm sure you'd agree with me. If we need to be perfect to go to heaven, then none of us qualify. We don't even live up to our own standards, let alone God's perfect law of love. And we don't need to read or hear much of the Bible's message to realize that God is perfect and that we are sinful. We're rebels, pleasing ourselves and not pleasing God. And we're barred from heaven. It's as if heaven has a no entry sign, no entry for sinners. And this is why this birth of Jesus, one who takes away our sin and makes us fit for heaven, why this birth is really good news for us. But we're all at different stages on this journey to see and realize things about Jesus. We're all on a journey. We could call it a journey of faith. And if we think about it, these characters in the story of Mary and Joseph and the shepherds and the wise men, they were all on a journey as well. And we're all on a journey either towards Jesus or we're on a journey away from Jesus. And as we look at the nativity story, let's think for ourselves what's going on in the minds of these characters. And it wasn't necessarily an easy journey, that journey of faith for them. Let's think about Joseph. He received some very deeply disturbing news, hadn't he? His fiancée was expecting a baby, but not because of him. And you imagine what was going on in Joseph's mind, how his life had been turned upside down. However much he may have loved Mary, he loved God. And he'd been brought up a good Jew, and he'd been brought up to see that to please God, you needed to obey God's law. And so when he heard about Mary's condition, he saw how wrong this was. It would be for him to marry her. And he thought the best thing to do would be for them to go their separate ways and out of the disgrace that she was before God. We're told he had a mind to divorce her quietly. Now, what about you? As you think about Jesus and the Christian faith and Christian teaching, are there things that trouble you? Are there things that just don't seem to make sense? They're not quite right. Now, we've got the advantage of the whole story before us in the Bible. We have the beginning and we have the end. We have Jesus' birth and we have Jesus' life and his death. And there's some things that just don't seem to make sense at first when we come across them. Maybe you've seen Jesus as a good man, an inspiring teacher, or someone who went about healing and helping people. And yet he was arrested and tried and condemned to death and executed on a cruel cross. And you think to yourself, this is wrong. This doesn't make sense. And you're tempted to put it all away, out of sight, out of mind, and get on with life in the best way you can, just like Joseph. But wait. Think about what happened next in Joseph's life. God appeared to him in a dream and explained what was going on. And God said to him, "Don't be afraid. This child is special. He's the promised one. He's God with us. He's someone who will bring about a great spiritual deliverance. He will save his people from their sins." And so if at first things in the Bible don't make sense, I pray that God will give you more light. Keep looking at Jesus. Keep asking God to show you more. Let's think about the shepherds. If you were to speak to these shepherds and the day before Jesus was born and say to them, "Tomorrow you will have a glimpse of heaven, of heavenly things, and you'll see the angels praising God in heaven, and the sky will be lit up." And they'd say to you, "Don't be daft. Don't you know who you're talking to? We're poor and simple shepherds. Nobody bothers with us. We're not like them important and clever people who teach in the temple at Jerusalem. Who'd listen to us? Who'd listen to little old me?" And yet God chose to announce the greatest news in the history of the world to these poor and lowly shepherds. And perhaps as you hear amazing things about Jesus, how he was promised many years before he was born, and that he is the Messiah, that he's the promised one who will rescue his people, and that he's the one who's praised by the angels in heaven. And you think to yourself, "Who am I? I can't worship him. I'm a nobody. I'm not rich or important." Think again. By announcing the good news to shepherds, God was declaring, "I am a friend of the poor and lowly. I am God who takes notice of those who ignore, those that the world ignores, and those that the world looks down upon." Remember that no one is too simple, too poor, too lowly to become a Christian. You don't have to have a brain like Einstein or a large bank account to become a Christian. You don't need great riches or great influence. God smiles when he hears the praises of the poor and the lowly. And I pray that God will give you a glimpse of what these shepherds saw, and hear and believe what they heard. Here was someone coming down from heaven to earth to lift up the poor and lowly and to take them one day from earth to heaven. And then finally, what about these mysterious magi, the kings, or the magi from the east? What was the hardest thing for these star studiers from the east? What was the hardest thing for them? Their journey of faith included a real journey, and perhaps that was the hardest thing for them. They made a long journey based upon snippets of information. They could easily talk themselves out of making a costly journey to Israel. They saw something unusual in their star observations that suggested that a king had been born. They may have had some knowledge of the promises of the Hebrew scriptures. Anyway, whatever, they had enough to convince themselves that it was worth making the journey all the way from where they lived to Jerusalem, where they expected to find the king, the newborn king. Now, what about you and me? We have far more than these wise men had. We have far more information about Jesus. You can read about this man who is human and divine. You can gaze at his character and work. You can see him teaching. You can see him serving and sleeping and hungry and eating and weeping and hurting and distressed and full of compassion and love. And you can see him in his divine nature stilling the storm or feeding the 5,000. You can see him healing the sick and raising the dead. You can see him, perfect man and yet condemned to die on a cross. Why? To bear away your sin and my sin. see him dead and lying in a tomb. And then on the third day, see him raised again to life. See him appearing to the many, many people. And see him ascending into heaven, where one day he will return again. And see the Holy Spirit poured out and given to the church to continue the work that he began. Now, if the Magi, on just a little information, made that long journey to come and see the young infant Jesus, surely we, who have all this information, can make the first steps of faith towards him. Surely we can pray and ask him for mercy. Surely we can ask him to forgive us. Surely we can call upon him to save us. When Mary heard the news, it greatly troubled her. But after she was given more information, she reaches a place of trust and she says, I am the Lord's servant. Joseph, when he first hears the news of Mary's pregnancy, he's perplexed, he's puzzled, it doesn't make sense. And then God reveals more information to him and he just does what God tells him to do. The Magi were filled with joy and worshiped Jesus. The shepherds were filled with joy and praised God. And you and me, as you think about these things, what will you do? What will you do to respond to what God has done in Jesus? And now over to Hannah.
Thanks, Ian. We started our service with the traditional carol, O Come All You Faithful. And our singing group is now going to come up and sing a new Christmas song entitled, O Come All You Unfaithful. It's easy for us to think, isn't it, that Christmas is just for kids and Jesus is just for those who have faith. But the words of this song remind us that Jesus was born to bring hope and rescue for those who are outsiders, for those who feel far away, for those who feel their own brokenness. The words will be on the screen, they're in your booklets as well. Why don't you follow along as look at the words and reflect on them as the group sing this song to you.
Christ is more. Christ is more. Glory.
Shall we now turn to God in prayer? Let's pray. Oh, holy Heavenly Father, we just pause as we come into your presence and pray to you now. Lord, you see into our hearts and see into our minds, and you see our lives. And Lord, you know whether we have faith in you or not. And Lord, again, we've been presented with the first Christmas account of Mary and Joseph and the shepherds and the magi and the heavenly hosts singing your praises. And Lord, we confess that we hold these things at a distance and convince ourselves that they're nothing really to do with us apart from a nice story. Lord, help us to see that you came for us, that you were born for us, that you, totally human and totally divine, you are the only one that brings us from earth to heaven. You're the only one who is able to. And Lord, we thank you that the angels saw something of this. We thank you that Joseph and Mary saw something of these things, that the shepherds heard and believed, and that the wise men, they made that journey to worship Jesus on the basis of little information. Lord, we who have so much, help us to turn to you in faith and to turn away from ourselves and turn to you. We ask, Lord, forgive us and cleanse us. Make us fit for heaven. Give us your life. We thank you for sending your Spirit. Thank you that you hear and answer prayer. And so, Lord, we entrust ourselves to you now. In Jesus' name. Amen. Just a couple of notices. We normally have an evening service, but there's none today. But please come back on Christmas Day next week to the services at 10:30 as usual, and it will be an hour long, and you're most welcome if you're able to come along to that occasion. And if children are coming along, well, adults I suppose, bring a favourite present to share, and I'll be part of the service on that occasion. And if you're able, please stay around and chat afterwards. There's refreshments, a lot of cake in the hub at the top of the stairs there. Collect a drink, collect some cake, and come back around in here, free up the space at the top. And we're now going to close singing together by Hark the Herald Angels Sing. That's it. Please stand. Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace. Hail the Son of Righteousness. Light and life to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings. Mild he lays his glory by, born that we no more may die. Born to raise us from the earth, born to give us second birth. Amen.